Much, much appreciated. Before we kick off tonight's event, and it's fitting that Nitro is founded in Australia, given all the Aussies. How many Aussies do we have here?
Yeah. How many did you get?
Yeah, it's spreading. So, Vincent, you want to just give a quick plug?
Very quick plug. Fin-tech.org got launched about 4 weeks ago. For those of you not aware, it's a platform that we've launched from San Francisco that's actually going to enable anyone, whether it's a person, a startup, or an event, or a resource related to fintech, to be listed. It's a very open platform. You just register yourself or your startup or an event that you're putting on. We obviously moderate it all, but that's just launched. It's growing organically. So if you do want to be more across other things that are happening, not just in San Francisco, but in other parts of the US, then just register to that, and over time we're going to enable you to get visibility to other events, or if you go to another city and you want to connect with other fintech people in other parts of the community. We actually have already been talking to the equivalent meetup to this one in Seattle, Austin, which we're hoping to set up, Miami, Washington, Chicago, and two in New York, about leveraging that platform as well. So it's very, very much an open platform for the US for the moment, but we're fielding some interest outside of the US as well. Finovate, as you guys know, we're helping them to just market it. They've agreed for us to get a free ticket for anyone who's registered to that. We're going to do a competition. So if you're online to that, someone's going to win a free ticket to Finovate as well, just so people are aware that it's happening. So that was all I wanted to say. And over to you. Thanks, Billy.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Vincent. And one other plug, if anyone is in New York this weekend or knows folks in New York, FinCap Dev is doing a hackathon in New York on Saturday. They did one out here at WeWork in February, and they're doing it in New York. So tonight we have a great panel. Really excited to have this group of guys together. And thank you all for coming out. So we're going to be talking about consumer financial apps and kind of driving behavior change. And you know, 5 years ago, we might have called this a PFM panel. But I think we're moving beyond that, and having run the PFM group at Wells Fargo for 3 years. It's a topic that's near and dear to my heart. So we've got some great folks. I think we'll just start with quick introductions from the panel, talk about the problem that they are solving with their company and their products, and then we'll delve into the topics. So, Rob?
Thanks, Billy. You guys, hello? Can you guys hear me? Okay. I always feel so underdressed. I see you, Billy. I think the last event I came to was half the size, so it was maybe a couple years ago, so Vincent's done a good job bringing everyone together. My name's Rod. I'm co-founder and CEO of a small financial services company called ReadyForZero. We help people manage and reduce their debt and also help them build their credit. And we've been kind of at it for 3 years, and we're a small team right down the street.
I'm Sasha, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of a company called LendUp. And the problem we're trying to solve is helping people that banks can and won't lend to be able to build their credit scores so that they can get access to better financial products. And we focus on people that traditionally look for payday loans and creating a market alternative to payday loans that's very transparent, embeds education, is very fast with an instant decision and instant deposit, so people can get their money quickly. And we built something called the LendUp Ladder, which helps people get access to more and more credit, larger dollar amounts at significantly lower interest rates, and start off about half of market. It takes people down to about a 16th of market, and we're the first and only licensed payday lender that reports to the major credit bureaus, so we can help people actually build their FICO score, which is the score that matters that banks and insurance and landlords and employers use.
Cool. Thanks, Sasha. So my name is Neil Wells. I'm co-founder of Planwise. We make financial modeling software that allows people to make better financial decisions. We kind of believe that financial decisions are really complex, difficult things that actually scare most people. And what we try and do is visualize that decision for people in our main tool, or we distribute decision widgets, if you like, via API that are specific to a transaction that gives someone a score and an affordability index for that decision they're trying to make. So put that decision in the context of their entire financial life.
And I'm Alok, Deshpande, and I'm head of GoBank, which is a brand new kind of bank account that's mobile focused and aims to be much faster, friendlier, and just easier to use. You can sign up in minutes from a phone, and 4% of Americans that were unhappily banked last year, and about $32 billion they paid in overdrafts. And I also run product for the rest of GreenDot, but just a couple jobs.
And if...
There's hashtag, and as Alok said, he's at GoBank, so you can either do GreenDot cards or GoBank when he says witty and insightful things. So, should we try this again?
Russian.
No, that's not working. So when I was running PFM at Wells Fargo, we like to say that people want to be better, younger, and richer, but they don't want to do any of the work to get there. So behavior change is a critical piece to getting to a better place with your finances and other topics, but we're here tonight to talk about finances. So there's been a great set of research from academics and industry over the last 10 years. So I just wanted to start by kind of talking about the academic piece of this and behavioral psychology and behavioral finance, and obviously Nudge and Dick Thaler is kind of the opening salvo from that body of work. But from an academic standpoint, Sasha, how have you guys thought about some of the behavioral psychology research that's out there and incorporating that in your product?
So this is something that I'm really, really proud of because it's sort of near and dear to my heart. I just as a little means of background, I was an applied math and behavioral psychology undergrad. So I just really liked measuring consumer behavior. And so that's one of the reasons why I love financial services so much, because you can, what better than what people actually put their money where their mouth is when making decisions. We also had the fortune of being part of and winning a great sort of little round table weekend, which I encourage all of you guys to check out, called Startuponomics, which is run by Dan Ariely and Michael Norton, who are very well-regarded behavioral economics and authors. Economists and others. And so we actually spent, as a result of this weekend, spent about a week of time building an infrastructure just specifically designed towards doing testing, infrastructure testing. And it can be everything from what are the words on the page to how does the experience look, and how do we run control and test groups in a very sort of rigorous academic setting. So we're actually working on a couple with Harvard right now and with Dan Ariely right now that we have not yet published, but I think it's really important because you can actually drive a lot of difference in behavior. So let's see if I can share. Do you remember the example that we talked about before this that I was going to share? No, I'll think of one off the top of my head. So we do a lot of testing. I'll give one. We created in part of our sort of loan agreement, we have legally required things as we're a direct lender that we have to disclose to the user, and we have to disclose it in a very, very very, very specific format, and there's no deviating from it. Otherwise, we'll be in violation of some federal laws. So we don't. But we also wrap something around it that makes it very approachable and understandable to the consumer. And at the very beginning of a startup, as most of you know or will know or hopefully will know, is you just kind of make stuff up as you go along. You got to make sure that you're following the laws, but you just write stuff on the page. And as a former mathematician, I'm far from a good copywriter, as Chris and Danny and Leslie can attest to in the audience. So I'm not allowed to actually write anything on the page anymore. But at the beginning, before we had somebody, I did. And so we wrote something that we call the honor code. And it's part of our sort of flow in which everybody has to commit to an honor code. And I just made up some language and we wrote it there. And we thought this was a great thing to test. And so we went in with Dan Ariely and then some copywriters, and we wrote a bunch of different versions. And the difference in performance, and in this case performance is loan repayment, because it's sort of our people committing to their honor code, we created a bunch of different tests, and the difference in performance from my control group to a lot of the tests was very outstanding. It was probably in the order of magnitude of 4 to 5% of repayment rate, which for a lending organization is a very significant amount. At Citigroup, we tried to hold repayment rate for our credit cards portfolio at 7%. So imagine the fluctuation of a 6% difference in swing, And it literally was the language and words on the page. So I love setting up testing groups. So then we decided to do it all over the test. We're constantly running tests, but you could have remarkable results from literally the words that you choose or the words that you don't choose, let alone how everything flows. So it's a very tangible example that has improved our bottom line just by writing different words on a page.
It is
crazy.
Is it tone? Is it kind of structure of copy? Is it literally choosing a more approachable word versus a SAT word? What's
So I think the test was something along the lines of I agree to the terms and conditions. One was like, I have read. I promise that I have read and agreed to the terms and conditions. Another one was, I understand and promise on my word of honor that I will pay back this loan. And then it can range anything from then representing that before a loan is due in a payment reminder to like, don't forget your loan is due, to here is the honor code that you agreed to that commits that you will repay this loan and do this. So it's a lot, it's tone, it's language, and it sort of can be approached. So I think it can be everything, but yeah. Is that right?
I do actually quite firmly believe that we're solving a behavioral psychology problem supported by technology. What we're trying to do is we're trying to help people make a better financial decision, and it's a really tough thing to try and get someone to do. Everybody wants more money, just like everyone wants to be thinner and stronger. And I kind of think it's a little bit similar to weight loss. It's a really difficult thing where everybody wants it, desires it, but it's very, very difficult to actually get someone to do it because it requires willpower, and you have a finite amount of willpower, right? So in the morning, you have to decide where you're going to spend your willpower. And if you decide to not spend it on losing weight or saving money, well, then you're going to spend it on something else, and that's it. And what I think part of what we're trying to do with Planwise is get someone to have the willpower to want to improve their life, and then replace that willpower with another emotion, an emotion that requires less energy, like happiness or fear, potentially. You know, and so they eventually don't need the willpower to get up in the morning to eat healthily or save their money. They're actually happy to do it, and they get a feedback loop through the technology that makes them happy. But there's a willpower piece at the beginning of financial technology, I think, that you have to overcome that very, very quickly.
Hello, Brian.
Yeah, no, I think that what's interesting is we focus a lot on getting people to understand a valuable product like GoBank against a sea of competitors that historically have done an incredibly effective job at convincing us that checking accounts are free, right? And that, you know, it's all in the fine print. And the other thing is, you know, there's an incredible sense of routine and rhythm and predictability where, you know, a surprising number of folks do exactly what their parents did, or the polar opposite of what their parents did, you know, but seldom one kind of in between when it comes to banking. So a lot of these basic habits, how we approach money, how we think about spending, the way we forecast and plan, are just kind of ingrained in little things that our parents did. So we kind of spend a lot of time trying to pick and choose which battles to fight. So pick the ones, the minimum set that sort of let people recognize the value, without trying to fight. If we presented a radically different notion of what a bank account could do and made every transaction unfamiliar or difficult, then I think we could quickly find that people would assume it's not the right product for them. It's for someone else, right? So it's striking that interesting balance of saying, can the and also backing it up with the explanation where a consumer can rationalize in their mind why we did something differently and why it's better for them in the long run. So people can understand, for example, that by not having retail branches, GoBank would have, you know, a better cost structure, and then that savings would be passed to you. But what they might not be able to understand is how through smarter technology we, you know, save them from overdraft fees. That just might not compute.
And talking about the behavioral financial piece of this, I mean, there's been a lot of research about the unbanked and underbanked over the last 5 years, and I think you guys are the first one to coin this term of the, like, unhappily banked.
Right.
So how did you, which I think is a pithy kind of
language. Kind of having apathetically banked in there too.
Yeah, yeah. How did you guys kind of come to that?
You know, it was, it really came from, I think when GreenDot originally, which was making prepaid cards, said, what folks who really didn't have a bank account. But that's actually a fairly small segment of the population, significant but small, right? A lot of other folks, you know, we kind of found in time, like we just kind of asked people what they thought. You would look at surveys of industries and banking was amongst the most reviled, right? And say, that's a good starting point, right? And then you'd kind of dig into why, and there'd be a lot of reasons that would come forth. But I think also if you ask yourselves around the room, the reality is, I don't find that many folks very happily banked. I find a lot of folks that are either apathetically banked, so their bank account works, you know, they know how to stay out of trouble with it, it meets their basic expectations, you know, and it kind of degrades from there, right? And you have those folks that just acutely had a negative experience. But it helped us kind of distinguish and understand the mark of the person we were going after.
Yeah. So Rod, I mean, behavior change, obviously you guys are trying to help people reduce credit, reduce debt. That is a fundamentally a critical piece for the consumer to have a successful outcome with you guys. How much have you been influenced by academics, and how much have you guys just been experiential learning in the market? Because you guys have been in the market three years. You were there when I was just trying to get stuff done at Wells.
Yeah.
You finally talked sense into it.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. Some academics have influenced what we do. So one of, I think, the most obvious is persuasive design. So what we've done is we've taken certain triggers and actually allowed people to take action on those triggers. So one simple example is we have large deposit triggers inside of our product. So if you get a large deposit, we will try to encourage you to take a portion of that large deposit and apply it to a high interest debt. And that, not only that, we will allow you to do that through the site so we can actually make that action possible. And we'll tell you how much it will save. So all that stuff combined, that feedback loop really encourages the right behaviors as opposed to hiding how much interest you're being charged and, you know, a lot of the things that typical banks will do. We'll highlight that stuff, and actually you'll be surprised, but it doesn't require some magic. If you highlight the right information for certain customers, they will actually take action in the right way. So, you know, we can talk about, you know, the academic components of it, but sometimes it's just surfacing information that's usually hidden away, and people will take the right action. So that's actually the one big learning through the large deposit alerts that we learned through persuasive design, that we can encourage the right behavior.
And Charles Doug from the New York Times wrote a fantastic book called The Power of Habits, where he talks about trigger, action, and feedback.
Exactly.
And so, yeah, it's a generic enough model that you can apply it to a bunch of different things, but it's also really critical to think about what's the trigger that you're anchoring against, and I think you guys have done a fantastic job there.
And actually one other piece to that we just recently added, I don't know if you've seen some of this, but we'll also automate that action now. So you can make bi-weekly payments based on that initial action that you made. So now you can set it, you know, and forget it. And so now you're not fighting that human element of, you know, they don't want to have that willpower, right? We'll just take it away and we'll say, look, we'll just remind you how much you're saving every month. So.
Yeah, no, I mean, automating and set and forget strategies are obviously very, very compelling. So in terms of driving behavior change, there's pieces where it's embedded or you're leveraging kind of triggers, and there's also an education component. Can you guys talk a little bit about where education is a standalone and what that looks like, and where education is ingrained in the product experience? And just I'll throw that out to whoever wants to jump in.
So one of the important things for us in sort of tackling an industry as hated and reviled as payday lending is you got to set up your business model to be the right business model that aligns your interests with your customers. So the first thing we did was we created a business model where we win when our customers win. And that's by sort of not enabling a lot of these debt traps that happen sort of around the industry. So the next piece was, okay, what is the goal of what we want to accomplish? And before I worked at started LendUp, and before that I worked at Citigroup and then the World Bank, before that I worked at Grameen Bank. Grameen Bank was sort of geared towards giving small loans to poor women in rural areas to help them create an income for themselves. And one of the things that we wanted was to create better customers by taking a life cycle approach instead of trying to keep people in short-term, high-interest debt. It's creating a life cycle approach and saying bad things happen to good people, but let's not try and make as much money keeping them in this bad situation. Let's try and get them into a better place and more stable and build their credit score. So one of the things that we had to do is we had to also think about how do we teach our customers to be better customers so they understand how the financial system works. So Danny, who is sitting in the back over there, is the runs our education section. So which is we tried to take very complex, very boring stuff like financial education and make it as exciting as possible. And so we did that by animating what we think are now, I think, 6 and then hopefully soon 8 of the sort of most important tenets of your financial life, which is about credit scores and credit reporting, your rights as a consumer, sort of budgeting, savings, et cetera, et cetera. And then, so we built this, and we had the same problem that you wrote, like, okay, we have this, and it's awesome. And we think it's the best, sort of easiest approachable education around. And we built tests, very simple 5-question sort of test to see if you mastered the idea. And if you did, then we want to give you better products. But how do we incentivize people to do this? So this was another sort of behavioral test. And we tried a whole bunch of things. We tried giving people money to take them. We tried incentivizing them with lower rates, with the ability to borrow more money. We tried just a whole host of tests. Because we wanted people to be better customers. We wanted them to learn about the financial system because we knew that we built our own software and we could build a good version as customers got to a better place in life. But we were having a difficult time embedding it into the experience. And so we did 2 things that I think were pretty fun that ended up working pretty substantially. One, which Rod talked about, which is incredibly important, is the power of real time. And so if you say, hey, we have these great education things and they're just like over there, go take them at your own free will. Chances are people aren't, because financial education is like boring. I love it, but like it's boring. I get it. So we had to think like, okay, we have to embed it, and so we did it in real time. So we looked at where are the moments in which there's inflection, and we can sort of integrate those and into the experience. So at real time, what are the pieces of information that are important at the right time? And we still have a long way to go, but we're starting to sort of embed and think about embedding education into the moments in which that education is actually relevant. And then reinforcing it. And then the second was, we tried all these whole host of things, and we finally landed on points. And our customers love points. That was a little fortuitous, as our co-founder was the former CTO of Platform at Zynga, so we had a lot of sort of experience, or we had a lot of resources experience sort of thinking about engagement, and how do you engage people to do the behaviors that you want? And in this case, the behavior was, how do we get more people to learn about financial education? So
and Sasha, on the points, do I get something material, or is it just a reduction in my self-loathing?
Like, what's with
that?
It's mostly just pride. It's point. There are points. I mean, nothing. No, I'm just, the points actually automatically translate into. No, people do love points. Points are this thing that's like I actually. We take it so that points automatically translate into statuses, and statuses give you the ability to borrow more money at lower rates for longer periods of time. So it's automatic, you don't have to like log in and check some box on the bottom of the third page on the bottom of the score and this like hidden thing. It just like they automatically give you better and better stuff. But then education is the fastest way to climb up the LendUp ladder to better and better things. So lesson learned is embedding it in real time, fully agree that real time and actionable things is much more important. And points. This is a take that don't worry about money, it's just points. Points are awesome.
Yeah, I agree with everything that these guys have said, that it's, if you're going to give feedback, I think education's great, we see that content plays a role, but content as a standalone thing is difficult unless the person already has the willpower to go and seek it out. But I think if you are going to do anything on education, it needs to be, we have a sort of a list of things that we try and make it a plan wise, which is it needs to be relevant, it needs to be timely, it needs to be actionable, it needs to be new, so something that they didn't know previously. And it needs to be timely. So that same sort of rules that basically you guys said, we sort of agree on that as well. If the feedback in terms of actions that people can take or education they need to have, we try and tick all of those boxes, but we, you know, if we can tick one or two of those boxes, then we think that piece of information is therefore something that we should give to that person rather than just firing everything to everyone.
We had a kind of funny story with education because when we first started building the product and coming from a non-financial background, we assumed that, you know, education kind of represented our failing in product design, right? If a screen required any explanation, and then you know we obviously made it unintuitive, right?
Can you just share where your team came from? represents, I think you guys have a really interesting background.
So kind of forged out of this, you know, maybe you might even say unlikely marriage between Loop, which was an early pioneer in location-based mobile apps, doing a number of things, and GreenDot, which is the US's like largest provider of reloadable prepaid debit cards. So the two of us coming together, having this conversation, and realizing that we actually both were really excited about this joint vision of reinventing, you know, banking with a definitely mobile on-the-go twist, right? So as we did those early drafts and revisions, what we found at usability testings was just that customers had tons of questions. And we tested some of the early versions of the GoBank onboarding experience, and we hadn't put any pre-login information. We didn't describe the features, the product, or the behavior. And I couldn't believe it, but I watched people reading legal agreements, like really going entirely through them, soup to nuts, looking for specific details. And we thought, I've just never seen this before. but we realized what that meant when you're thinking about finances, which might be the one place where people do pay attention or need that reassurance before they take the plunge, is you've got to fish out the information they're looking for and be proactive and transparent, put it in their face. We actually added an additional legal agreement, which was just a summary of, we think this is the only stuff you're really going to care about, yep, the rest of it, but don't take our word for it, read it. You're welcome to read the rest. And then picking and choosing the information we put up front, but yeah, it was surprising finding.
Can I ask you a question? Maybe pertinent to where we are, forgive me for interrupting, but I haven't heard the word video. I'm just really curious about how you guys view video and how you use it on your platforms, or will, when things happen.
Can you repeat the question?
You want to know about the use of video in the specifically to education or just
education, for example?
Yeah. So the video is significantly more engaging than like a page of text that I wrote. I can guarantee that. So the first step Danny did was animate the videos. So we have we work with a production and animation shop to animate the videos, and I write a bunch of boring stuff, and then Danny makes it a little more interesting, and then we work with the production shop and we animate it. And that is one part. And so we're just about to actually start launching some live education pieces where we're just literally gonna film ourselves talking about frequently asked questions from our customers, tips and tricks about our product. And so I don't have any results about whether it will be successful or not, but it's cheap and it's easy, and we have a bunch of stuff that we want to do. And so we'll take an iPhone just like that one, potentially, or maybe something better. We'll go into a conference room, and we're just going to film short snippets of all of the things that people ask us and they want to know. So maybe I can be invited back in the future, and then we'll show the difference between a text-based FAQ and some video stuff. But it's definitely more engaging. And now that mobile bandwidth is significantly more important, and for our customer base, a mobile phone is actually the primary source of traffic for us, and around we can fit it in, you can watch short lo-fi videos, and we hope that's going to be really awesome. Rod has an awesome video of himself on his website.
Yeah, actually, so one counter to doing some video and multimedia, in our case, is that you have to be very careful of the tone, right? And so when there's humans talking about something that may be embarrassing, right, you have to be very sensitive to that. So we did some testing where people felt like they were maybe being spoken down to about their finances. That kind of stuff is hard. I mean, there's a very fine line, right? And it's true with content in general, right? So you have to be very sensitive to that, especially around financial stuff. So that's one learning that, you know, you found. So testimonials and things like that actually work much better, at least in our case, than, you know, content-driven.
And most of your testimonials are kind of customer spotlights, right?
Right, yeah. So just, you know, talk about your situation and how we helped you, right? Or how you helped yourself is even better, right?
Right. Sure. Other questions from the audience?
It would be really interesting to hear what each of your number one behavior you're actually trying to change is that drives your business model.
Sorry, and so can we just say where we're from? I know you're from a video storage company. Sophie, I know where you're from, but for the benefit of the rest of us.
I work in the U.S. Treasury Department Office of
repeat the question for the camera, please.
So I guess the question was, I'll repeat the question, it was how we drive the behavior that drives our business model,
what's the number one behavior you're trying to change in your customers that drives your business model?
Right, okay. So in our case, our customers succeed when they're reducing their debt and improving their credit, right? And so those are two numbers that are easy to measure.
Yeah.
Okay, so we drive those, and in turn, we actually have premium offerings to our customers that help them get there faster. So we have a free product that helps them get there, and that's measured, and we've helped people pay down over $150 million in debt so far. So it's measurably impactful. Then they upgrade, and it's even more measurably impactful. So that's how we do it, and so it's those two things.
So for us, it's about focusing on the financial decisions. So in the real estate space, we do that by trying to get people to engage in a wealth score. So we score them, you know, score the property, you know, whether or not it's going to increase or decrease their wealth, and we do them an affordability index. So we really try and sort of drill it down to bite-sized pieces. We sort of think there's two questions that people are facing around a decision, usually a large decision. It's can I afford this and will I make money? And so we kind of optimize around those two questions.
For us, it's really having people that are retained in the product and love using it for a long period of time, since our business model is entirely aligned with people sticking with the product for and really banking out of it. So the two kinds of behaviors we're trying to change is reconsider, you know, what banking solution they basically want and do they need a branch. And really it's the breaking down the psychology of switching, like how difficult is it actually to change banks. Probably the two hardest behavioral switch banks.
Making it really hard to switch banks?
No, we're trying to make it easier to switch banks.
It's good clarification.
Let's see, so if you might, probably our, I would say there's two, because we're sort of a mission-driven company, so we have two. And they're both pretty much the same thing, but one is sort of short-term and one's long-term. The short-term one is how fast can we profitably move people up the LendUp ladder, which would transition people off of payday loans onto a stable financial product. And then my personal long-term goal, which just unfortunately takes time, so I don't get to talk about it too much because it just becomes frustrating and ask more questions, is how high can we raise people's FICO score? Mm-hmm. And so that will be the long-term goal and the number one metric that we will sort of live by, but we're just an early stage startup and changing the FICO score has so many extraneous factors. We're just starting to learn now how we can affect it, but that's my personal.
Cool. Good question. Thank you. I've got more questions, but I'm also open to. I know you do. I'm just seeing if anyone else. So go, Vince.
I was going to say, at what point in the evolution do you feel like a lot of the potential to effect change is through testing, right? It's getting in front of users or putting out an experiment and having that test run. I mean, some of that can happen super early. And I think from memory, ReadyForZero was almost founded out running an experiment that then turned into a bit of software dev, I think, if I've got my history right. But in practical terms, some of the experiments require enough points of data. So in terms of, you know, the 2 or 3 years that I think, I know for 2 or 3 years between all of them, at what point are you doing what kinds of experiments and potentially what kinds of tools assist that process?
Yeah, that's a great question, and we've, despite having questions across the entire product, have really started with where the customers began. So when the product was brand new, it was really focused on, you know, what was that initial message that we were presenting them with, and what was the singular message that woke people up and said, hey, this is why I might consider something new, right? And then you kind of like move through, you know, the onboarding flow, and this may be seen entirely self-evident, but you know, we did spend some time up front optimizing things that we then realized, you know, people can't get there. Doesn't really help.
Sure. Thank you. So, we have a couple things. We have engagement that we try and measure in terms of how engaged is the person with the product, and we have a score system in the back end that I invented, so it's not particularly clever. Which tells the person how much have they come in and interacted with the product, and we try and obviously push them up through the score process, and that's how we sort of ourselves in terms of our own success. In terms of tools that we use, we recently started using Mixpanel, and if anyone who uses Mixpanel in their product will know it's amazing, and I highly recommend if you're not using Mixpanel, they've got an event on tomorrow night, you should go to it. And it was really, really eye-opening for us to see what it is that, people do inside the software, and then what do those people then go on to do. And a really basic example for us is we allow people to make multiple plans, so you can make a plan A versus plan B, and you can turn a plan A on and plan B off. So it's really basic scenario testing, which is really hard to do if you want to try and do it yourself, but we do it with this really simple button push. And what we discovered once we put Mixpanel in is this was an incredibly engaging thing for people. And in fact, 30% of people who click that button come back into the software again. And so that kind of is the kind of thing that we're starting to do now, where we use something like Mixpanel to really kind of like hone in on something and work out, hey, the people that do X, they come back and then do Y. So that's sort of, I think that answers your question, hopefully.
At a high level, I think a lot of the testing is at the exploration, conversion, and engagement or retention. So as we sort of bucket things in that kind of framework because they're each independent and they're all relative to each other. I mean, related to each other, but if you can isolate each of those things, then you can focus on optimizing them. So Mixpanel, and we're also big fans of Optimizely. So the first thing that we do is the challenge of a small company and a startup versus a big company. But we kind of decide what are the tests that we want to run, and then we just let them run until we have statistical significance. And when we were really early, that took a couple months. And now it takes a couple days, depending on what we're optimizing for. But I think the important thing is figuring out what the segments are that are important to your business, and then figuring out what are the right tests, and then worry about when significance comes later, because it'll come at some point, hopefully. they just go wait till time, and that just.
I don't have much to add, I guess, but there's a lot of low tech ways you can test stuff too. I think we did paper and pencil, so a lot of people discount that completely because they want to build their thing first and then drag a bunch of traffic to it. But you can actually learn a lot by putting something that you just drew and say click here with your pencil and click there. And also competing sites or existing bank sites, all things that we did early on. So we're a highly technical team, but not building anything was actually a huge advantage, because then we could say, don't want to do that, do want to do that, they've spent 6 months building that, let's go just put people in front of it and see what the response is. So those are the tools I would recommend.
Can you have an ongoing experiment on your site with a phone number?
That's right, my phone number, yeah. And every email I send out,
that's right.
Yeah, no one calls, actually. So not even you, Billy.
Yeah. It's a plea to
the
audience.
Obviously, it didn't need to be flashed
up. Something that we learned really, really nicely was from my co-founder, who worked at Zynga for a long time. And Zynga, one of the hardest things that YC teaches you to do is prioritize. And not work on
YC for those.
Oh, sorry. YC is Y Combinator. It's an incubator group that helps sort of accelerate companies, small startup companies, into bigger ones, hopefully, like ReadyForZero and LendUp.
And Luke.
Right. Yeah. What's up, Planwise? Let's get it. Zynga never built anything. They would put something up on their website. They would have a concept and they would have an hypothesis. They'd put something up on their website and they would not build it until a certain amount of people clicked on it. So until they built a new super cow and decided super cow were the way to go, they would put a super cow on the website, and people would click on it. It would pop up a message that said, "We're thinking of building a super cow. Not ready yet. Thanks for clicking," and then close. And so it's a great way to not spend a lot of time wasting engineering resources on something that nobody actually cared about, despite how good it sounds. So we've adopted that as best as we can, but it's really interesting. Another part, which is we haven't adopted paper and pencil yet, but maybe we'll do it soon, is we just actually call people and ask them. Now that we have an existing group of customer base, and before that it would be coffee shops or Jake and I standing in front of payday lending stores and asking people questions. But it's like amazing. It's not
quantitative and specific number. You get a lot of really good qualitative data about just asking people some specific questions and some open-ended questions. And we have a whole dedicated customer insights team that does this. They literally just call people up and ask them questions.
So we talked about this a little bit on the prep call, but in terms of onboarding, how do you guys think about onboarding, and how does that set you up for behavior change? Yeah, set your customers up for behavior change, and what do you guys do that you think is compelling on day one versus day seven versus day 30? So.
I haven't talked too much to this.
I'll jump in. I'll start. For us, we looked at this slope from basically that first sort of interest to actually switching banks, right, and actually making this your primary account. And there's a lot of steps along the way. There's building trust and believing that, you know, we're in fact who we say we are, that they'll live up to some of the promises that we're making, and then actually sort of starting to experience the use of the product. And we found, not surprisingly, in the financial space, I mean, there's just a lot of, people really need to see a demonstration that things are going to work, right? So we kind of think of this from, you know, the initial onboarding, that first funding, to you getting a debit card in the mail and activating it, and then like you engaging with different features, and then us gently sort of encouraging you to switch other activities across, right? And at each step, trying to show you what the potential upside is. And then what we kind of look at is just, you know, how many other people have made that switch at every stage. What's that next step for them?
Yeah. I think gently is a good point.
Yeah.
Financial apps are very different from other apps in that they have a trust barrier that a lot of other pieces don't have, right? The consumer needs to trust us as a technology company. The banks need to trust us as a technology company. There's trust in there. So gently is definitely a really good point. And I think humans, there's some humans that are really good at going and creating their own path. There's probably a lot of them that are in this room tonight. And then the vast majority of humans are really good at walking down a path, but you need to put the path in front of them. And we discovered that early on with Planwise when we first launched it. You know, you kind of had to find your own way through it. And we didn't have a great sign-up rate. And we put a tour into it that said, hey, this is how you walk through it. And our sign-up rate went from sort of 2 to 3% up to about 17%. So that kind of like humans, some of us are really, really great at going with the machete and cutting our own path, but the vast majority of humans, you need to lay the path out in front of them, and you kind of need to let them, they do the walking, but you need to tell them, hey, walk down here, guys. So I think that was very valuable for us. And then gently, in terms of email messaging or marketing, in terms of onboarding someone once they become a user, making sure that we're not, you know, trying to shove too much stuff down their throat too early. We build that trust gently.
Another question, I'm gonna go.
If you have insightful, pithy things to share, go.
Let's see. So one of the things that we learned was that our customer, when in dealing, most of our customers are in a very scary time in their sort of financial lives. That's why they turn to payday lending. It's a very unstable, stressful time because they don't have enough money to do something that they really need to do that's stress-inducing. Like most of the starting points into payday lending are typically a medical emergency or a car accident or not being able to pay the bills at the end of the month. And so our message is to help people over the long term. And so we are constantly learning about what the right messaging is. But what we've for sure learned is that what our customer needs at the moment when they're first learning about us is to know that we're going to solve their problem immediately. And so if you go to LendUp.com, you might just, which I encourage you guys all to do regularly, you just see some messaging that is surrounding about fast, instant decision, instant deposit, which is very important to our user base. Because what they want to know is, I need to solve this problem. I can't think about anything else. I have to solve this problem. It's the only thing on my mind, and I have blinders on. But as soon as they know that their problem is solved, there's sort of this sense of relief. The message doesn't matter anymore. The money is already in their bank account in a matter of seconds. And now it's time that we can educate somebody about the long-term benefits of building credit and the importance of building credit. So we're constantly trying to find a balance between the government and customer advocates so that people understand actually what our long-term value is. But to our actual customers, we've learned is they're not open to learning about anything until their problem is solved. So
literally the instant that they are approved, which happens instantly for every single applicant, the messaging switches entirely to what is the long-term benefit of being able to borrow more money at better rates and building your credit and education and dashboard and reminders and thinking about the days. So, but it's hard to, you know, get a customer advocate to like log into our site and say, look, I told you, like this is what happened. So we spend a lot of time building a lot of other education so that we're, our value prop is transparent across the rest of the site through other links. But really, it's the customer that is the most important to us, and they're not open to listening. It's probably akin to trying to sell somebody that eats a McDonald's hamburger and fries every day just to eat a salad. Well, it's like, first let's go to like a small fries, and then let's go to like a Diet Coke, and then let's go to like maybe a turkey burger, and then like then let's have a side salad, and then like, oh, let's have a salad chicken on it, you know, but like you can't just be like...
We've gone through the whole value.
Yeah, yeah.
Rod, you got...
So we're talking about onboarding, right?
Onboarding.
Yeah, onboarding. I mean, I think one of the things, testing. I mean, we know exactly the drop-offs, and I think, quite honestly, it's not insightful, but, you know, getting people back who do drop-off is a big area that a lot of people ignore, right? So especially in financial services, why did someone drop off, and can you just pull them back, right? So they're not lost forever. So I think that's one thing that is insight and onboarding.
Yeah. Retargeting.
No, we do retargeting, but in this case, it would be they got halfway through, right? And so we'll message them specifically where they dropped off to come back, and it'll be easy to pick up where they left off. So.
And Sasha, you were just talking about gradual changes. And Alok, you talked about you didn't want to, when you're getting people to switch to a bank, you didn't want it to be too radical,
right?
So on the GoBank website, there's the opportunity to use an online checkbook,
right?
So my question is, what's a checkbook?
You know, that's a great question. That was one that we looked at ourselves, because personally, I couldn't even tell you where I have a checkbook. Maybe somewhere, right?
What made you guys keep that?
Well, when we went through it, we looked at, and we kind of swore it off to start with, but we realized there are these, you know, people have to interface with the real financial world, and these, and the other strange thing that popped up to us is a lot of customers immediately gravitate when they're wondering on a decision like this to that 1% case. So what if I buy a house? Like, you know, or what do I do when I need to give my daughter money for a field trip? Aha, like, you know. So
yeah.
So those are the kinds of cases that we, you know, looked at the edge problems, and you know, there's ways to solve the problem today, and there's more elegant ways we're always looking at. But yeah, that's something to just be aware of, is like you kind of have to pick and choose with each financial instrument whether the complexities or, you know, but unfortunately what we'd love is where people could work with a product that is always predictable and was always, you know, bounce free, headache free, and unfortunately that's not the way that the financial system came about when it first created. So with each of these we look to see how we can bring that value proposition across to something as antiquated as a check.
When I moved to America, I opened a bank account. We don't have checks in school. No. And the teller said, "Here's your checkbook, Mr. Wells." And I said, "I don't have a checkbook." Very bravado, I handed it back. Until I had to pay my rent. And he only accepted the check.
We've got about 10 minutes left. Other questions from the audience? Nick.
I'd love to know how your customers find you and what the best conversion rate, or what source has got the best conversion rate.
The ultimate question in financial services. We're trying to
figure
that out.
Does it need to repeat
still.
The question, or were you close enough to the mic? Okay.
So the question was, where do we acquire customers and what's the best conversion rate from what channel, I guess, is specifically. In our case, content works really well, and is a channel that has one of the highest conversion rates if you're going for organic channels. So for example, an article that has a specific testimonial about someone who's paid off debt, right? In our case, right, to be very specific, that converts really well into our product because someone is tuned into that, was looking for something there, and, you know, converted into our product. Paying for customers.
we've tried to actually differentiate ourselves across, and so not advertise explicitly in the areas where there's, you know, a debt relief company or, you know, in some cases a payday company or something, you know, not to say that they're all bad, but we try to differentiate, you know, by not advertising in those verticals specifically, because then when you're there, you're suddenly compared to those people just inadvertently, right? And so those other channels may not be as high volume, but they convert much better, right? And so that those are just, you know, a few things we learned. But we haven't figured out, you know, the secret sauce really. But yeah, content actually works really well. We have to generate it, has to be fresh. I think Vincent mentioned that, right? That's one of the attributes that's really hard to keep up as a small company. So
yeah, I mean the there's no silver bullet, I don't think, for customer acquisition. It's a pretty hard one, I think, for everyone. Right? Everyone's trying to fight against it, because if you pay too much, it ends up, you know, you're never going to get the value back out of the user. So we have some success with content when we do have enough bandwidth to produce it. We certainly do see when we're active with content that we do see better engagement. But the other thing we do is we think about Planwise as a capability, not a destination. And so rather than trying to draw people always to planwise.com or get.planwise.com, we allow our technology to go and live where the person is making the decision. So we partner with real estate portals at the moment, and we place our decision technology within the property listing. So trying to not remove the person away from that, but this is the point in time that you're trying to make the decision, so let's serve it to them then. So we actually partner with people to distribute our technology as a way of trying to bring down our CAC or even make it negative in some cases.
Twitter.
Yeah, that's the answer he's looking for. Well,
that's what you wanted?
Well played.
My favorite channel is when somebody types in LENDUP into the browser directly. That has a high conversion rate and is a very cost-effective mean. Fortunately, it doesn't happen quite as much. So one of the best converting metrics we have is we're one of the first, or maybe the first, sort of socially responsible short-term lender in the space. And so what we can do, since almost all financial management companies range a broad spectrum, is partnerships is actually one of the best sort of opportunities that we have and one of the best channels that we have, because inherently in almost every place where people are looking for credit, there are a lot of, banks can only approve so much, you know, about 20 to 30% of the entire industry. That means there's 70% of other people that are sitting there that they can't approve. Because regulation, underwriting, et cetera, et cetera. So we have a competitive advantage there. We have a clean brand. We can help people build their credit, and we can approve people that banks can't. And so we're finally a solution that can help people offer something to the majority of their customer base they've never been able to do before.
So what do those partnerships look like? You said partnerships are very effective.
Yeah, so... this is all right. Let's talk after there isn't filming.
Okay.
I don't want to inadvertently name one that we
sure.
Or leave one off that
sure.
is a great one.
Fair enough.
But yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. No. I think that much like what everyone else is saying, I mean, it's we initially looked at we initially looked at our just initial conversions and things like that. And, you know, with a product like GoBank, really success is a happily banked customer, we realized we actually had to go look a little bit at the entire picture and say, you know, not only who made it through the registration process, but who did they kind of grow up to be, right? And what we, I mean, certainly it's great when people find GoBank directly, they read a press release. I think the things that we found are, you've got to look at moments where people are putting their financial hats on, right? So when they're kind of already considering the idea of, they're confronted with financial choice, right? So there's these major life moments where these things happen, like married, people take a job, people have that first, they go to college, they move, So we kind of look at those moments, fortunately all the other banks do too. And then I think there's also seeing the product in a trusted context, so actually seeing the product in action, and that's kind of why we partner with Project Runway.
I was gonna say, is that a life event?
Yeah,
Project Runway.
Yeah, exactly. That was people got to see people actually use the product in the course of the season, which was kind of
I mean, you guys had a really aggressive, I mean, and you're this interesting hybrid where
right.
you guys are this startup team in Palo Alto, but you've got the mothership down in Pasadena. And so you've got resources that the rest of the panel doesn't necessarily have access to. And so you had a really aggressive launch plan last year with all the retail distribution that you have, the online portals, obviously Project Runway has been done. And so, I mean, I'm sure there's fascinating learnings that you guys have on this.
So we did
it.
We did this because we realized, and this was true for GreenDot also, was there's really two dimensions to getting the word out. One part of it is just this basic baseline awareness, right? So making sure that customers have heard of it before, that when you actually target them with a performance-oriented ad, they have some context or some anchoring that helps. I mean, our biggest challenge is we have basically 45 seconds to build someone's trust in a banking institution, right? Which is tremendously short regardless of what we say, right? So it helps to have that context and backstory. And so the challenge is always you're not going to see maybe direct results from some of those efforts, but you'll actually see it just boost the effectiveness of other outreach. So.
But for a company, the question is related towards people that are just starting off. When we just started off and we had nothing, if you're just starting your company, it's fintech. We went to AdWords, it was expensive, and it sucks to compete against people that have a lot deeper pockets, and it's not a long-term winning strategy, but it works really well at the beginning when you're just trying to prove to see if your product actually works and matters. So you can get to a point where you can do a partnership with Project Runway, or get on the news, or get an article in TechCrunch or whatever, and then put it on your homepage.
Yeah, exactly. I would definitely say you should start with press, start with ads, and start with your friends and family. Like, just ways, the first thing that we did with GoBank is we all tested it, right? And then got friends to test it. And if you can't win in the circumstance where a person's pressuring their family member to give them a product to try, it teases out all of those obstacles to, like, why would a person be reluctant to switch?
Third question.
So, I started focusing on GoBank, but you have this really cool
Professor Dog, right?
Okay. So, what can you tell us about how the dog affects the user's utility or willingness to pay you?
It's entirely the dog. Now,
feel free to explain. Other people might not.
So GoBank's mascot is a dog, Professor Dog, and it's actually our CEO's dog, believe it or not. Yes, he's dog. He kind of came about just from this idea that, like, what would be a benign, sort of friendly, playful mascot instead of, a lion
or
something that something that you would typically associate with a bank. And we've we debated a lot internally as to how to use Professor Dog, throughout the product, and we found out early that people don't like talking to dogs, like, you don't want to get financial advice from a dog.
So that implies you tested it.
Great. Decided not to go with that. But as a playful element and as a piece of character or as a person sort of softening the blow, like, if you ask us for some budgeting advice and we tell you, unfortunately, the majority of the time when people ask, it's no. So he has this really sad help. So that I think that it adds to the overall message we wanted, which is our approach to making banking friendly, but you have to, like, with everything, use it carefully.
Yeah. Other questions? Yes, Jake.
Do you count confidence as an alternate to behavior change still successful? Like, if somebody went and used Planwise or ReadyForZero or one of these other applications and then did exactly the same thing that they were going to do in the beginning, but did so with more confidence and better assurance that they're going to be, that was the right decision. Like, that, it's almost impossible to measure, but you think that, like, how do you think?
So, right. So if your consumers make more informed, more confident choices, is it a good outcome?
Yeah, I think it definitely is. Like, you know, I think that's part of what we're here to do, right? And you know, I think we measure it by whether or not they come back into the tool. If they keep coming back into the tool, then I think we've done the right thing. But yeah, giving someone confidence to do the thing they were going to do anyway, I think that's how I use my own product. You know, I've lived and breathed financial services for a fair while. I usually know what I'm going to do, but doesn't mean I don't model it myself first anyway, just to make sure it's right. So yeah, I think as long as people are getting that confidence, it's right. I mean, very early on in Planwise's life, we had this internal debate about whether or not we were helping people take control or alleviating fear. And like, yeah, we were trying to work out, what are we doing here? Are we assisting a bunch of people who are seeking control, or are we like helping people like avert a catastrophe or a fear? Yeah, it's a good question. But I think as long as the people get what they want and they come back into the tool, then we've done our job.
I think yes, in our case, it's actually not rocket science what we do, and you know, we're very open with that. And so if someone understands how we're doing what we're doing, and they go like, or even teach other people, hey, this is what I learned on this website, yeah, that's huge success, I think. And then, you know, I think it's demystifying, you know, what's there. So I guess I don't know if that was exactly your question, but yeah.
Yeah, I guess so. We tend to measure ourselves like how we, like how many people came down debt using ReadyForZero, and like we compare like what they did prior to that versus what they did after, right? But you know, what if those two things are the same, but the consumer is better informed?
Huge success, I think. But yeah, ideally they're still with ReadyForZero. And actually, interesting.